Welcome to the Philippe Matthews Show, live here on Google Hangouts in Sacramento and around the world. Thank you for tuning in. I have a very, very special guest with me in a very, very special time. Dr. Martin Luther King's birthday is today, and I could not have a better guest on in his honor. We're going to be talking to he's formerly known as Booker T. Coleman, but his formal name is Kaba Hawathe Khamenei. And he is the facilitator and chief executive officer of the African-centered Science Academy, Per Ankh, Temple House of Life, and has been an educator since 1977. He has consulted on many educational boards, schools, community parent programs, and groups, and his work and dedication to Afro or African-centered information and education is unparalleled. If you have ever had an opportunity to download and watch the three episodes or documentaries called Hidden Colors, make sure after you have this wonderful event with Dr. Coleman, make sure you go and see this because it changed my life, and I'm certain it will change yours. Hidden Colors is a trilogy of, I think, 6 hours of incredible information about really African Americans and Africans, really, where we come from, how we inhabited the planet, and we're going to be talking about that and the Moors and more on the show. And so welcome, Kaba. How should I address you, my friend?
Brother Kaba is fine.
Brother Kaba. Thank you, Brother Kaba. Thank you for being with me today.
My brother Philippe, I thank you for inviting me.
We had a three-hour conversation previously, and we went through everything and talked through so many aspects of who and what you bring to this wonderful planet of ours in terms of knowledge and information. Now, you're currently author and facilitator of The Humanity is Born in Africa, Africans Traveled the World Study Guide. I want to talk to you about that. Can you explain to us what this study guide is? It's about 80 pages of incredible, incredible information. How can people get access to it, and what is it about specifically?
There are two ways that the family can access the study guide. You can go onto my website, www.pantherprince.com, PANTHERPRINCE.com, and you can download that and other pieces of information that I have on that site. I also have a few of my DVDs regarding the Moors, the Africans in medieval Europe. Or you can email me at Kamene777@AOL.com, Kamene777@AOL.com. And what's interesting, Brother Philippe, is you're recognizing the Hidden Colors series, the documentary that I was asked to participate in, along with many other, many great scholars.
Yes.
And after it premiered in New York City, or I believe the date was April 16th, 2011. That was Hidden Colors 1.
Mm-hmm.
And many young people, and many people who may not have known the general information, came out afterwards, and I was standing outside greeting the community and thanking them for coming out to support the film. And many of them were overwhelmed with the information, because as those who have not seen it have no idea what it's about and maybe not be familiar with the true history of the world, African history, it will take you back to a point where you'll wonder, where did all this come from? And when a lot of the young people came to me and asked me, well, where do we go from here? I thought it was going to be about hip-hop. I thought it was going to be about Nicki Minaj and Drake, and because the trailer was put on World Star Hip-Hop.
Right.
If you know World Star Hip Hop, you know, understand what I'm saying. It's a site that is more of current events, let's say.
Sure.
And so when
Brilliant marketing.
Oh yeah, absolutely. And it was, because it brought out young people who would never have thought to come out.
Right, exactly.
Had they not been, had they not seen it on World Star Hip Hop. And so they just came out. And I realized that while for those who knew this information, it was nice to see it in the context. It was nice to see it in a professional setting. It was nice to see the photos that backed up the information. However, for some folk, it was overwhelming. And I realized that something had to be done.
Well, you know, it's interesting you say that because I saw it, and the moment I saw it, and then I couldn't. It was one of those things where, you know, there's not a lot of programming that alters your life and how you live it. So I literally had to stop working. I had to stop doing everything because I could not leave it and turn it off and try to go back. I had to go through it through the entirety, and then realizing there was more than one, that was three, and I said, okay. So I literally took an entire day, and I went through this content, and I swear to God, I called everybody, and in my space, in myself, I said, okay, Philippe, you have a I have a responsibility as a person in the media. A person who has been doing online media and interviews with brilliant minds since 1998. When I saw this documentary and I saw you in particular and Dr., you know, there's a lot of scholars on here, you know, Dr. Umar Johnson, Tariq Rashad, who produced it, Anthony Browder, Dr. Valentine, it's a sundry of great, brilliant minds. I saw that there was a responsibility that I had to bring people like yourself on to go even deeper into this because it was awakening for me, and I'm 50 years old. So I can only imagine what it was for people who have never seen it. As you said, it was overwhelming when I saw it, and I'm somewhat aware. So I can only imagine what that would be like for kids and for people who have never even considered who we are as Africans in America.
Yes, absolutely. With that, I decided I was going to shut down for 2 weeks, and I assembled all of my material in outline form. And instead of when people stop and ask me, you know, well, I saw something that you did, can you give me a book to read? Mm-hmm. I decided to actually develop a study guide. And as you said, it is 71 pages of outline materials. It goes by themes, whether it is the origin of life in Africa, the African presence in Asia, the African presence in Europe, the African presence in America, African spirituality. It looks at Africans coming to America post 1492, and so it deals with the issues, and it lists the books to read, and it not only lists the books to read, but it gives you themes to study: physical anthropology, geography, history. It breaks it down that way, and then it gives you the chapters in the particular books to read that relate back to that particular theme. I teach college, and I know that my course outlines, when I develop them, are long themes. And I very rarely, if ever, just give a student a book to read. I normally have three books, and I will take chapters out of each book that complement the theme. I'm a thematic teacher. I don't teach books. I don't have book clubs. I have theme clubs. That the way in which the entire study guide came into existence reflects exactly what came out of Hidden Colors in my experience as someone who is attempting to lay out information from a scientific perspective. I have moved away totally from the emotion of what we're facing because I realized that very little teaching and learning can happen in emotion. You know, like in your epiglottis, when you're eating and breathing, the door has to close over one in order for you to breathe. And then it has to close over another in order for you to swallow. And that's how I think about thinking and learning. Learning is the type of thing that you got to shut emotion off and let science be able to come through you. And then there's a time that you can shut down the science and go to the mental or the emotional aspect of learning and then relate the two through the two hemispheres of the brain. Mm-hmm. So that the way the study guide is set out, it is set out to walk a learner through a process of common sense as to how we gut. And here's the questions I want us to be able to answer when you finish. I want you to be able to know, who am I in this world? Where am I in this world? How in the world did I get here?
Mm-hmm.
What am I supposed to do in this place?
Mm-hmm.
How am I supposed to do it? And what do I have at my fingertips in order to achieve my goals in life? Mm-hmm. That is, to me, what the whole aspect of this thing we call life is about. It's not about how many cars you have. It's not about how many sneakers you wear. It's not about how much money. Because when all is said and done, when you go to your judgment scene, as the Egyptians, the Chemites would tell you, there's only one thing you bring with you. That's your heart and your soul.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what you're weighed by. Nobody cares how much you got. They want to know who you are and what you've done in this thing that they've given you, this gift of life.
Absolutely.
That's what I try to get our students to understand.
All right, get to that. So the two things that we were talking about in the green room that I think we wanted to get across was, one, talking about and how this relates to the study guide and the information that you, I mean, the study guide is amazing. It is absolutely amazing. It's basically the you know, the literary version of watching the visuals of Hidden Colors. I mean, it blows you away. But one thing that I think a lot of people, when we hear, scientists say that, well, we've discovered that Africans were the first people on the planet, and that we have unequivocal proof, and we have fossils, and we have Lucy, and we have all of these things to show that Africans were the first on the planet. I think what most people think is, okay, then where did European or Anglo-Saxon white people come from, and how did black turn white? And then secondly, we hear this concept of the browning of America, the browning of the world. And is it true, is it possible that if you believe in Darwinism and understand that, that the Anglo-Saxon or the white Eurasian basically had a time frame to be here, and everything is going back brown again? Can you speak to us and walk me through, or walk us through, those two aspects? One, how did black turn white? And then the process of it going back to brown again.
Let me give you an example. Now, I don't know about California folk.
Okay.
In terms of weather.
California, what are you saying?
It's warm there all the time. But when you live in New York City, and right now it's 16 degrees outside my window.
Oh, wow. Ouch.
We go through season.
Yes.
Okay. Right now, I am not the complexion I was in July in New York City.
Sure.
If you can imagine this happening over an extended amount of time, millions of years, if we could understand that no matter what our complexion is in New York City, that when we are in the presence of the sun, and the sun is beaming down on us with all of his, her glories,
mm-hmm.
we become a particular pigmentation because of what the sun does to our skin. As the summer moves on, the fall comes in, there is a transition in pigmentation. And so by the time you get to this day, January 15th, happy Martin Luther King Day,
mm-hmm.
I am a complexion a tone or two lighter or less pigmented than I was in July. That's a natural reality. And that's why they have suntan parlors, and that's why people try to go to warm climates in the winter in order to get that healthy look of brown to black again. Now,
mm-hmm.
let's go back to the very early part of the sun, before the planets. Let's go back to cosmic history. And the sun, by the nature of its life, is going to throw off pieces of itself. And it's going to hold through gravitational pull, through centrifugal and centripetal force, it's going to hold these entities that it threw off of itself, circling itself in elliptical orbit. There is going to be a particular orb that is going to be close enough to gain the heat, but far enough to be able to be cold, that is going to have a perfect balance. And that's going to be the third planet from this sun, which we call the Earth. Our ancestors called it Geb, G-E-B. It is going to be a gaseous ball. But over time, through interstellar cold in space, it's going to balance itself off, and it's going to begin to get a core that is a very hard core. Over time, it's going to be what we call the water and the earth. Life is going to come up out of the waters. Now, I'm speaking, moving away from religion. I'm speaking science at this point.
Sure, absolutely.
The life is going to start as single cell entities and singles. And again, I encourage people to look at Cosmos. That was just done by Dr. Neil deGrasse Tyson. Or if you go to one of his teachers, Dr. Carl Sagan, in the 90s, Dr. Sagan had a series that he called Cosmos. And
yes,
this is where this scientific information, along with other things, John G. Jackson, and a lot of information, it's here.
Sure.
And so what's going to happen is that this single cell is going to begin to multiply itself, going to go through a lot of different situations, is going to go from this single cell, is going to start a botanical life in the waters. Then from that is going to become the age of the fishes, the age of the fishes is going to become the age of the reptiles. The age of the reptiles is then going to become the age of the mammals. And then life is going to go through a certain course through life. There are going to be the age of the dinosaurs, but at the same time, there is going to be entities that are going to be in the trees, that's going to live the arboreal life. And they are going to have a common ancestor. Some people call it Ramapithecus. Some people call it a number of things. But Ramapithecus, part of Ramapithecus is going to come down onto the earth and is going to develop a sedentary walking on the earth life. There's going to be another part of Ramapithecus that's going to remain in the trees. Because of the nature of the life that the one on the grasslands has to live, they are going to have to adapt to a new way of living as it relates to the foods that they're going to eat, as it relates to the life that they're going to live. So this life system is going to go through various changes. It's going to basically become the entity that we call Australopithecus robustus. Robustus, robust, it's a thick, heavy human. Early person, very hair-like, and is going to have a slanted forehead. Eventually, because of the way it's living, Australopithecus robustus is going to slimline itself, is going to lose more of its hair, and is going to be called Australopithecus gracile. Gracile meaning graceful, sleeker. Australopithecus gracile, because of the way it's going to live, is going to start to think about ways in which it can better its eating, and is going to start to develop things that it can use as it relates to the nature around it. And that's going to be called Homo habilis, human of ability, or the tool maker. Homo habilis is going to live a certain lifestyle that the more they think, the better they eat, the better they eat, the better they think. And that is going to make this entity rise up and stand erect. That is going to become Homo erectus. Homo erectus is going to live the type of lifestyle that when you're bent over, you have cataracts or interruptions in your liquid systems going through your body. However, when you stand erect, you're going to have straight flow of your circulatory system, but more importantly, in your central nervous system, it's going to open up a part of the base of your brain known as the foramen magnum, which is going to allow cerebrospinal fluid, which bathes the nervous system in a way that they are going to start to think on a whole nother level. This Homo erectus is the first form of human that leaves Africa. Evidence that life came from Africa is that for millions of years, the only part of our family that existed lived in Africa. If everyone who is watching this program, no matter what your culture is, whether you are Japanese, whether you are Albanian, whether you are French, Native American, even if you are Nigerian, or Ghanaian, you can trace your family back to what we call the Great Lakes region, the countries that we today call Congo, Kenya, Uganda, Tanzania, and parts of Southern Africa. Every human comes from there. There's no human that did not have its original family born in this Great Lakes region.
Now, one of the things I remember in Hidden Colors that I absolutely love is obviously in that six-hour documentary, and there, you know, it's three two-hour documentaries, and so when I say 6 hours, the whole thing is 6 hours if you watch all three, and it goes through literally every single culture and where and how Africans migrated and moved into these various different parts. What I love about what you brought to that was what happens in terms of the weather, the climate, all of these variables that alter the original African and creates all of these various different cultures. Can you speak to us about some of those processes?
Okay. Homo erectus is going to become Homo sapiens, thinking human.
Mm-hmm.
Homo sapiens is going to become Homo sapiens sapien, or creative thinking human. This Homo sapiens sapien is going to find himself in the northern climate of the planet, which is basically, as Dr. Shekanta Giap, in his wonderful book, Part 1, Civilization or Barbarism, he outlines this. And he talks about this movement north of the 51st parallel. The 51st parallel latitude line cuts the earth. It cuts Ireland in half. It cuts England in half. It goes across Holland. It goes across Eastern Europe into Western Europe. I should say Western Europe into Eastern Europe. And it cuts into Asia. And it's almost like a polar cap. There are four major ice ages that are going to impact this area, starting give or take about 1.7275 million years ago. The first one in Europe is called the Gunz Ice Age. The Gunz Ice Age is going to it's going to stop, and there's an interstadial. There's a warming trend. The next ice age that it leads to is called the Mindell. After the Mindell, you're going to have the Riss, R-I-S-S. Going to come into the Worm Glaciation, which is the fourth, but the Worm is going to be cut into two parts. During the first part of the Worm Glaciation, there's going to be an interstadial, and you're dealing with basically maybe, give or take, maybe 70 to 60,000 years ago. Africans are going to find their way into this area during the warm or the temperate climate, and they are going to settle in this area, not realizing that within a couple of thousand years, up underneath them from Greenland is going to come the Worm II glaciation, which is going to create ice mountains across the polar cap, which is going to forbid them from being able to cross back over into southern lands, and they are going to be put into an ice age where, if we think, like I say, it's 16 degrees, imagine if it's upwards of maybe minus 100, minus 200 degrees below zero.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
This is the kind of ice we're talking about, and not only that, but that ice age is going to last 24/7. It is recorded that some generations never saw the sun. It was nothing but one cloudy day every day of their life.
Wow.
Now, maybe not in California, but in New York City, we stay indoors more.
Right.
When it gets cold. During the summer, we're outside playing and hanging and talking and enjoying ourselves and slowly walking home.
Sure.
Okay. Now, when you get to this weather, we got our head straight ahead, and we're moving as quick as we can, and we're trying to get into a warm place.
Now, you forgot, you forgot
more clothes.
That I'm from Chicago. I was there 40 years, so
okay.
I know about some cold.
Okay.
So you know, I'm in California now.
Yes.
But I understand personally what you're talking about and going through.
Hey, yes. They don't call that the Windy City for nothing.
No, they don't.
So, I mean, when you think of the psychology of what we're, put the emotion aside.
Sure. Sure.
Deal with the science of this so that we can very clearly understand what brings this into existence. So in going into the caves and in putting more clothes on, this skin that was pigmented becomes a problem, as it does for me right now. It's a problem because this is natural suntan lotion.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So the body has to do something. Now, here's where we study science. You basically, some people say four, I say five. You have five layers in your epidermis, in your skin. You have the stratum. You have the stratum corneum, stratum lucidum, stratum granulosum, stratum spinosa, stratum basale. Those are your five layers in your epidermis, in your skin.
Mm-hmm.
In the bottom two layers, in the stratum spinosum and basale, you have a biochemical called 7-dehydrocholesterol. See, this is why I say to people, don't believe me. I'm not here to make you believe me. I just want to make you think. And if this is of interest to you, study it. Don't believe me.
Right.
Study 7-dehydrocholesterol and see what it does. See, you have vitamin D1, D2. There are four different types of vitamin D. We all say we need vitamin D, but we don't specify which one. Mm. Vitamin D1, D2 is inactive. However, when the light and heat energy from the sun comes down, it is pulled into the epidermis to go down into the two bottom ones, and when it blends with 7-dehydrocholesterol, when it absorbs itself, the light and heat energy, that 7-dehydrocholesterol mixing with the light and heat energy of the sun then transforms D2 into active D3 and D4. That's the vitamin D that's good for our bones and good for our bodies and allows us to absorb the calcium.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
In the lack of sunlight in the ice, this becomes detrimental. This dark complexion becomes detrimental. So in order to let the little bit of sunlight that may have come to the northern climate, this skin had to depigment itself for the same reason my skin depigmented itself in January, in order for me to get the proper sunlight because of the lack of the sun that I had with me in July.
A natural biological process for survival of the species.
That's it. That's it. So becoming so depigment, and then of course in our hair we have in our hair follicle we have sacks of an oily waxy substance known as sebum.
Mm-hmm.
And as the body needs it, these little packets explode. And they send a sebum to the scalp and along the hair follicle. This is what protected the Africans in the hot climate from getting scalp cancer.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
However, when you move away from the heat of the sun, what would have been cooked in the heat of the sun now is allowed to remain as an oil on the scalp, and it attaches itself to the hair follicle on the outside, and that's what makes what we call kinky or nappy hair straight. There's no good and bad hair. It has nothing to do with that.
Right.
It goes
all
back
science.
To nature.
Right.
The oil produced in the heat cooks the scalp and protects it. And out of that protection, it makes the hair kink or nap into elliptical orbit. In the colder climate, the kink or the nap is the oil comes down on it and it straightens it out, mm-hmm. and therefore you have straight hair. The nose is going to change. It's going to go from a very wide basal index right up in here. It's going to go from wide to very aquiline because you don't want all that cold air to come up in through your nostrils.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
There's a scientific principle. Heat expands, cold contracts. If you have a ring that is very tight on you in the summer, or I should say loose on you in the summer, when the wintertime comes, you put a ring guard on it because you know that your finger is going to become thinner.
Mm-hmm.
Our bodies swell. I know I hear a lot of people talk about how their feet swell in the summer. Their bodies swell. Mm-hmm. Well, that is all part of this process of the heat and the cold. So what would have been a dark complexion, curly hair, wide nose, thick lip human being that is used to living in very hot climate, now in the cold climate is going to have to depigment itself. The hair is going to get straight. The nose is going to get aquiline, the lips are going to get smaller, and the morphology or the body type is going to change. And in that weather, hair is going to grow profusely in order to protect the body from the cold.
Absolutely makes sense.
You look at Glozier's law, Bergman's law, Allen's law. Don't believe me. Go to science. Because as Malcolm told us, and as there's a clip of Martin Luther King, is in the denigration of the word black, and in the angelicizing of the word white, devil's food cake, angel's food cake. In making everything black bad and in everything white good, it gives a false impression as to how science functions in this. Nothing whatsoever to do with good and bad, superior or inferior. It has to do with science. It has to do with nature. And when we understand nature, we understand that these individuals who morphed out of us to become the Eurasians that we know today in the northern climate, and the ones that are in the Netherlands, the ones that are in Norway and Sweden, you will notice that the more north you go, the blonder the hair, the bluer the eye, the lighter the complexion, the more pale the skin. And that is because as you go north, is less sun, and as you go south, there is more sun, or light and heat energy, I should say. And it had nothing to do with good or bad. It has to do, and you see, if the human family had only thought about this from the beginning, we would not be going buck wild crazy talking the nonsense that we talk today as a people. And this is the cornerstone. Now, it would also be true that in this, we are now experiencing, we are in the middle or an interstadial of another war, of another trend in climate. So now we have what we call global warming. Now here's Kaba's idea. Others think this too. I do not think that human beings created this warming trend. I think what we made detrimental about this warming trend that was coming anyway was that we polluted the water. Since the last time we went through this, we've polluted the water.
Global warming is just a natural ebb and flow of the cosmology of the Earth and the rotation of around the sun. It's just a natural thing.
Absolutely correct. And this is a globy. This is a globy. A global warming. This is the Earth warming itself just like it froze itself. Now there's a global warming, and you notice that the ice caps are melting. You notice that there are phenomena that are happening. You're noticing that animals are living. My goodness, there's a hurricane. There's a tornado in Los Angeles a couple weeks ago.
I know, right? Exactly. Yeah.
Come on. A tornado? Come on. What's going on here with this tornado?
Right.
You know, there are tornadoes now in places that never had tornadoes before.
Right.
Now, hurricanes going to Hawaii. I remember the hurricanes that would come and go to Florida or go to Louisiana, or we go to Mexico. But now we have those other hurricanes that are coming, and they're going up the Pacific.
That's right.
Something on the planet is happening. Humans had nothing to do with that. So that this global warming now is going to, and I tell this to peoples of Eurasian descent, I hope you're listening, that we are returning back to the black. We're returning back to the original archetype of the human family. In fact, when the Eurasians first came out of the mountains of Europe after the Ice Age melted, the first thing each and every one of them should have done, they should have done what I call the Robert De Niro. They should have found the blackest person that they could mate with in order to keep their family in place. Yes, I said Robert De Niro.
I had to come on out. Come on, brother. Come on, brother. Kamba. You know
I hope you didn't have him on your program.
I'm like, now where did Robert De Niro come into all of this? You know because you ain't right. You know you ain't
he
right.
Only dates black women. He only dates black women because he knows the only way his seed will continue is to plant it in a black woman.
You're amazing. You're amazing. I love you. I absolutely love you. Okay. All right. That's what I should have did a Robert De Niro. I'm loving that. That's great.
And he'll tell you that.
So, for the sake of science, what should have happened is that the Eurasians should have made it back into black.
Yes.
As opposed to looking at it as, oh my God, you know, where I think we are at now, and that is, okay, how are we going to preserve the population of the Eurasian?
Yes.
And literally turn against ourselves in a sense and turn this into this global phenomenon called racism and slavery and all of these things that came from that.
Absolutely. Absolutely. And people like Blumenbach, who back in the 1800s, who developed these racial categories that did not exist in the ancient world.
Right. That's right.
I mean, the categorization of someone by the nature of their skin color or by the geographic location they came from, that did not exist. There were terms for people who were outside of the home base, but you were not judged in a sense. Like, you were judged by the content of your character.
Sure, sure.
Now, not by the color of your skin.
Speaking of that, so where did or when did the Moors come into our history line through the, as it relates to this evolutionary track that you've just laid down for us?
Now, there are many people that will say many things, but for me, Moor means black.
Mm-hmm.
So I could have said to you from the very beginning, I could have said instead of Africans or instead of blacks, I could have said Moor the whole time.
Okay, okay.
So the Moor to me is the African at a specific time in history that's going to have that word attached to them by the Europeans that they come in contact with.
Ah, all right, well said. Okay.
Which I see to be 710 AD when Africans from North Africa, from Morocco, and from Mauritania go into Spain and conquer Spain under the leadership of Tariq. And they are going to move through Europe. And it is to be remembered that if you go back to the Greeks who went into, and by the way, Greeks don't exist. Even Alexander was from Macedonia. Greeks don't really exist. That's a figment of an imagination. Those people don't exist. And it wasn't called Greece at that time. But that's a whole separate history lesson. The idea is that when you're dealing with these Eurasians that are going to come from the northern climate, the same northern climate that we're talking about, are going to come down, settle along the Mediterranean basin. They are going to move, and when they get into that Mediterranean basin, they're going to meet Cushites. They're going to be Africans living in the Mediterranean basin, from Italy to Sicily to the area that we call Greece to the area that we call Turkey, right around to France, Monaco, Spain. There are already black folk there. They're going to mingle with them. They're going to get a sense of the information. And then another northern Germanic tribe is going to come down. They're going to settle themselves around the Latium Mountains in Italy. They are then going to be called the Latins. They're going to now move into North Africa, and they're going to come upon Africans. And we're talking about the Punic Wars. And this is where Hannibal comes in, and a number of things are going to happen. But if you go back, the Romans are going to take a faith system that they found in through the Coptic Church of Egypt and Ethiopia. They're going to mix it with Zoroastrianism, where their savior's name is Mithras, and the Romans are going to enslave the Greeks to teach them what the Greeks learned from the Africans, and that is going to give birth to the Holy Roman Catholic Church. The Holy Roman Catholic Church is going to fall somewhere around the 400s and the 500s by another wave of Eurasians that are today they're called the Visigoths, the Ostrogoths, and the Vandals. They're going to push south, and by the time they get around near the coast of Spain, Africans are going to become aware of it. They are going to go to Ceuta and make a deal with the Greek governor of Ceuta, and they're going to cross over into Spain, and they're going to conquer Spain. And they're going to remain in Spain, that they're going to call Al-Andalusia. They're going to remain in Spain and control Spain. They're going to bring universities into Spain, the first universities. They're going to bring libraries. They're going to bring soap. They're going to bring something that they call alcohol, which we today call alcohol. They're going to bring in strawberries, the Valencia orange, the razor, and they're going to bring in one of the most dangerous things. They're going to call it the fire stick, and that's the birth of the gun. Africans brought that into Europe. And so they are going to control Europe from 710, July of 711. 710 is when Tarif came over and reconnoitered. But 7/11 is when Tariq, July of 7/11, this African is going to go into Spain, conquer it, and Africans through three dynasties, the Umayyad Abbasid dynasty, the Almoravid dynasty, and the Almohade dynasty, they are going to control Europe. And in going into Europe, they're going to start an educational system that is going to give rebirth to the education that the Greeks got from the Africans. So the Greeks got the Nazans, and somewhere between 710 and 1100, Europe is going to receive the Renaissance, the rebirth. We don't even know that the Renaissance was started by African people.
Amazing. So, now, again, this is also what you're having in your study guide. You give the books, you give the science, you give all of the information where people can go and track and trace this history for themselves. So this is not Afrocentric hyperbole.
No, this is world history.
Yes.
This is world history. Dr. John Henry Clark, my teacher, once said that the missing pages of world history is African history. Mm-hmm. And until we understand, because you have to ask yourself, where did these Europeans like Galileo and Da Vinci and all these get all these ideas from overnight? Where did they come from that they could create an entire compendium and encyclopedia of knowledge in every of the liberal arts? Where could it come from so quickly where you don't know where it came from? Well, because the Africans that taught them. And in keeping the African out, you'll never understand how that information got there. And so, when in 1492, when the combined towns or families of the Castile and the Aragon, Ferdinand and Isabella, joined forces and drove Boabdil out of Granada on January 2nd, 1492, that is what gave birth to Cristobal Colon receiving monies to be able to retrack the steps that he was on with Africans, which led him to what they call the New World. Mm. But when they got here, there were Africans already here. You see, the indigenous people that we know of today, that we call indigenous, mm-hmm. the Cherokee, the Choctaw, mm-hmm. I have five nations that run through me. But I got to tell you, not one of them is original to America.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And for those that
want to see that, because that's one of the things that came out, Brother Kappa, that's one of the things that came out in Hidden Colors as well. Let's talk about that because, you know, we are taught that Christopher Columbus discovered America, which kind of now is a running joke because we realize, okay, joke number two is that the Indians were here before Christopher Columbus. But what we don't talk about is that Africans were here before the Indians.
Absolutely. There is a brilliant scholar, Dr. David Imhotep. He wrote a book called The First Americans Were Africans. On his cover, he has a picture of an indigenous person that is from Tierra del Fuego, South America. And I just encourage you, I'm not going to tell you what the individual looked like. I'd like you to research it to see it for yourself.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
In this book, they have found a woman's skeletal remains in San Diego. San Diego, south of you.
Wow.
And she dates 90,000 years ago.
My God. Wow.
See, when someone tells you a perfect lie, the mm-hmm. truth is unbelievable.
I like that. I like that.
See, because when I say things like this and I go and I discuss things, people say, wait a minute. Okay. No. The Native American looked like Cochise and no. Look, if you just look at the name of California, is named after Queen Khalifa. That's a sister with braids.
That's right. That's absolutely right.
So I tell people, don't believe me. When you go to Hawaii, King Kamehameha.
Right.
Was a brother with a short afro.
That's absolutely right. Now let's talk about that a little bit. I have said this many, many times when I was young. Now, of course, I have scientific proof of it. But when we look at the Buddha, because this is very controversial to a lot of people, and cultures. But when we look at the Buddha has braids, a braided, knotted hair. And if you look at the ancient Asians, it becomes very, very clear that there was an African line there. Speak to us about that.
The whole world is African.
Absolutely.
You see, and in our minds, with our social construct of these different races, or these different, see, there's only, and you know, folk jump on my case because they'd like to think that Eurasians are other than human because of the way they conduct themselves. But I'm sorry, my science just doesn't tell me this. And if I'm going to present myself with any form of validity, I have to be consistent in what I'm saying. And, you know, there is only one race, only one human race on the planet. That human race was born, nurtured, sustained, educated in Africa.
Mm.
And after Africans got their show together, then they took it on the road. And we have to be clear. We have to be clear to get the paralysis out of the analysis. In order for us to come forward with a very clear history of our world and the people and the animals and the nature that reside on it. And the bottom line is that the first wave of human beings on this planet that lived on this planet, and they were the only humans on this planet, were black people. And it wasn't until Eurasians are fundamentally no older than, I'm going to give them a lot of credit, they're no older than 8,000 years old. See, because we've been in this all our life, we think this is the way it's always been. Behind the untruths that has been told about their accomplishments. And so therefore, we are in like a little vacuum where we're perceiving the world the way in which other people are telling us it existed. So for me to say that there was an African woman found in San Diego living there, that's 90,000 years old, that's wild. Folk don't realize that this latest group of indigenous people probably came to this part of the world, give or take, about maybe 500 BC.
Wow.
And they came during the Asian invasions, and they would find themselves coming across the Bering Strait. But they don't tell you the other stories because the first humans that came to America came by way of Africa. They did not come by way of the East. It's a shorter distance between Africa and the American hemisphere than from Asia or Africa to the west coast of the American hemisphere. The first Africans came here via Africa, not via the East. The first people to people South America probably were Angolans, Africans from Angola, Southern Africa.
Unbelievable. Well, you know, and I shouldn't say unbelievable. It is believable. It's just unbelievable of the lie.
Yes.
And the history of the lies that have been told. What's being taught in school about African Americans, African history, is completely fabricated and completely aberrated. So this study guide, how do you teach the study guide? And again, give people the way so they can download this and they can receive this, because I think this needs to be in everybody's home. That is especially our children. They need to know. All our babies need to, all our brown babies around the world need to have this in their possession. And I'm going to even talk to you about figuring out a way to put it in a different forms so that we can get this information out, because it is the science, it is the truth, it is not Afrocentric hyperbole. And how can people get this study guide?
You can go to my website, www.panther.com, pantherprince.com, and you can download it. Or you can reach out to me by email, kamane777@aol.com, K-A-M ENE777@AOL.com. And the guide itself is developed over a very consistent manner, because I get into African cosmologies, and as you get into African cosmologies, you know, you get a sense that this is a very large universe with many different wonderful possibilities in it.
Mm-hmm.
And that you go from cosmology into what I call solargy, which is the study of the sun.
Mm-hmm.
You go into earth science, the study of the earth. Then you go into organic life, upon which humans have to be part of organic life, the mm-hmm. living planet, mm-hmm. from botany to zoology to human biology. It's all related. It's all consistent. You can see yourself. If you took a plant leaf and your skin and lined it up side by side, they look exactly alike.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
And the study of melanin in the humans is like the study of chlorophyll in the plant.
Mm.
But the sun acts on chlorophyll like the sun acts on melanin.
Well said. Very, very good.
There's a consistency, Brother Philippe, and this is what I try to get to community. Leave your emotions at the door.
Yes. See, now that's what I want to speak on that a bit, because one of the things that attracted me to your work, and a lot of people say, well, Philippe, why don't you talk about racism and the Afro-American plight? And one of the things that I developed over the years is this thing called SHOCK. SHOCK stands for Seeking Higher Omnipotent Conscious Knowledge. And so I just kind of became my own self-scientist, if you will, and seeking the experts around the globe that could give me unfiltered, unfettered, non-emotional science. And that is one of the reasons why I don't get caught up in the emotion of racism and all of the things that, because that is so secondary or tertiary or whatever to the actual issue of science. And so I'm so honored that I found you and that you took time out to give me the time of day so that I can bring this information to my constituents, my people, my followers, because it's not about emotion. This is not about let the emotion, and also speak to us about not just letting go of the emotion, Brother Kaba, but also we kind of got to let go of the religion aspect of it as well, because that is one of the bonds that is actually holding us down so that we can't really understand and respect the science.
Absolutely. You know, it's interesting because there's a natural progression that when the early human beings were first on the planet and they were developing a sense of order and arrangement in their lives and seeking order and arrangement in their lives, looking at nature and attempting to make parallels between nature and their life,
mm-hmm.
They began to look at, let's say, the sun, for instance. They began to look at the sun in, let's call it, a superstitious manner.
Mm-hmm.
They created superstitions about the forces and powers around them. They were superstitious about them. They developed habits that related to superstitions. And so, therefore, they ordered and they arranged their lives around superstitions. And then as they became more adept at it and they realized that the force was a deeper, energetic, spiritual force,
mm-hmm.
superstition became religion.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
And they created ordered and arranged ways of worshiping what they used to be superstitious about. They created stories and analogies and metaphors, and it became religion. Then when they began to go deeper into religion, they began to realize that science, you know, is the study of nature, and that nature was the essence of God.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And so what was once religious became scientific. Now, scientific means knowledge. The Greeks had the word gnostic. It means knowledge. It means knowing. And that this science was seeing spirituality.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Spirituality is unseen science.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
Science is seeing spirituality. And that I believe I'll tell you a story. I was once told by someone, I went to a college to speak. And it was a very Christian-oriented college.
Okay.
And I was talking about cosmology. I was talking about science. I was talking about things dealing with God, the essence of God, the essence of the Creator. And one of the later speakers looked at me and said, "Brother, I think you have left the church."
Mm-hmm.
And in my comments afterwards, I reflected back on his comment. And I said, no. The reason you don't see me is not because I left the church. It's on the Holy of Holies. I'm in the sanctuary now.
Mm-hmm.
I went deeper in the church. You're still sitting in the pews.
Right. Nice.
Because
yeah.
The bottom line is, there's a brother by the name of Jeremiah Kamara who has written a number of books on religion. And he once told us at a seminar that there is a proverb, I believe it's a Buddhist proverb, that says, to continue, the greatest organizations meet their people's needs and solves their people's problems.
Hmm.
And he said, to belong to a religious system that no longer meets your needs and solves your problems is equivalent to carrying the boat on your back after you cross the river.
Nice. Nice. I love that. I remember you telling me that. I'm so glad I got it on tape. I got it on video. That's amazing.
It becomes very important.
Correct.
Because
yes.
What got you across the water,
mm-hmm.
when you needed it, it was there. Celebrate that.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
But if you continue to carry the boat on dry land, it becomes a burden.
Absolutely. Well said.
And so the Creator gives us all these wonderful things.
Yes.
Like the man that was in the street, and there was warnings that there was going to be a flood. And a man came by in a car and said, "Come on, man, come on in here, man. There's going to be a flood." Man said, "I'm not worried about it. God will protect me."
Mm-hmm.
Man went on.
Mm-hmm.
The rain comes and the water starts coming up. He gets real high, up to his chin. All of a sudden, a boat comes by. He said, "Come on, man, get on the boat. There's going to be a flood." Man said, "I ain't worried about it because God will protect me." Water continues, goes over his head, and a helicopter come, throw a rope down, and say, "Come on, man, you're going to drown." He said, "I'm not worried about it. God is going to protect me." Well, man drowns, he dies, he goes up to heaven. He faces his God. He says, "God, I prayed to you. I have faith in you. I told everybody you were going to save me." God says, "Shut up, fool. I sent a car, a boat, and a helicopter for you, and you didn't listen."
Never gets old. I love
so
that.
So we never know how things are going to come to us.
Never gets
we
old.
We never know how it's going to come to us.
Absolutely. Absolutely.
God brings us things. The Creator brings us these things. And so what we think is a curse is really a blessing.
Yeah.
And so that it becomes important, Brother Philippe, that we open up ourselves to a new way of living and working with each other in the deepest and most profound way.
Absolutely.
And
well, he's paraphrasing Einstein, saying, I'm paraphrasing Einstein, saying, you know, the thinking that got us to where we are is not going to be the thinking that is going to take us to where we want to go.
Absolutely.
So it just, when we think of evolution, does it not make sense that the religion or the faiths or the beliefs or the spiritual customs of a particular time in a particular era would not apply to a different era? Would that not make sense? Because even if you look at history, religion evolved. So why is it so difficult? And I'm speaking to my people, my African American people, my melanated people. Why is it so difficult? I'm asking you the question rhetorically, in a sense. So difficult for us to step outside of that box and look at the science that exists and look at the truth that exists. Why is that so frightening for us?
Because this is how I've observed it, that we were snatched from our homeland. We were snatched from everything that made sense to us. We were brought to a hostile environment, an environment that we had never known before. And when we got to this location, the Americas or wherever it was, we were told a story about a man who very much lived the same type of existence that we had. You know, when you look at the story of Jesus the Christ and what he went through, I mean, on Holy Thursday, you know, the Thursday, right, he has a big feast for his disciples. He even washes their feet. And he is, as a human, he's afraid of what's about to happen to him. So he goes to the Garden of Gethsemane. He brings a couple of his boys with him. And he says, you know, I just want you to let me know when the Romans are coming. I'm not asking you to do anything. Just let me know so I can prepare myself. So he goes in and he starts to talk to his father. He says, yo, Dad, please, you know, like you're God. You know, you could snap your fingers and everything would be all right. You know, why do I have to go through what I know I have to go through? Why do I have to go through? And then he heard something. He goes back and he sees that his boy's asleep. And he says, wow, you know, like, can't you stay up? I, you know, with all that we've been through, I'm only asking you to just stay up. Let me know when they're coming. Oh, Jesus, I'm sorry. Okay, man. Okay, you go ahead back, talk to Pop. I'll take care of it out here. We'll watch. We'll let you know.
Mm-hmm.
He goes back, but something overcomes him. And he says, okay, Father, if this cup cannot pass over my head, let thy will be done. And something comes over him, and he goes, the Romans are coming, and his boy's asleep again. So he doesn't deal with them. And all of a sudden, coming out of the group of Roman soldiers comes his best friend. And his best friend comes and hugs him and kisses him. And Jesus says, you betray me with a kiss. You know, that's a very powerful analogy.
Yeah, it is. Yes, it is. Yes, it is.
You know, to point to somebody and say, there he is, that's one thing. But for the symbol to be to kiss your best friend, and that's what's going to make you grab him? He says, wow. Peter. He said, yo, Jesus, I got your back. You my man. Jesus says, Peter, shut up. Because before the cock crow three times, you're going to deny you even know me.
Mm-hmm.
So I tell these stories, and I get it. I'm a teacher of Philippe. I can't help but tell stories. I tell stories because black folk are plantation. Going through this pain of being enslaved and tortured and raped and denigrated and dehumanized, going through this, and then being told this story of this man that would split history in half and literally be so honorable that these people who enslaved him would honor him and enslave them in his name, they held on to this story tenaciously. And it's what helped them survive this ma'afa, this terroristic disaster. And this is why I don't come down too hard on our people, because this has become a crutch for them. This has become something that has allowed them to go through Jim Crow. It's allowed them to go through dogs being sicked on them. It allowed them to forget about Mike Brown being shot and Eric Garner being choked. It allowed them to be able to live this horrendous hell in this world. And so I know that it is a false security, but nonetheless it is a security for a people who may not know better. So what I say to
us, necessary is, evil. It's a necessary
their house is on weak stilts.
Sure.
If we knock those weak stilts down because they're weak, their house will fall. And what I am saying, those of us who know, love them, honor them, respect them unconditionally, but in the process of that, place stronger stilts underneath the house so that the weaker ones will fall away. The greatest enemy we have on our planet, Philippe, is not white people. It's ignorance.
Absolutely.
It just so happens that there are a whole bunch of white folk that are very ignorant. Ignorance gives birth to fear, false evidence appearing real, and that's denial.
That's right.
Fear and denial gives birth to white supremacy.
That's right. Or any other
form of supremacy, whether it be male over female supremacy, any form that makes you feel that you are better than someone else because they are who they are, is not a reflection of them being weak. It's a reflection of your inferiority and insecurity when you're in their presence.
Absolutely.
That's why I think our people hold so tenaciously to Christianity. But there is a new wave coming.
Yes, it is.
And when that new wave comes and we're able to build those stronger stilts, our people will wake up out of this slumber and they will put themselves in their divine destiny, which I believe the African American is meant, was born to save this planet.
No doubt. I agree with you 100%.
All
evidence and science points to that.
Brother, ain't nobody been through what we've been through? Ain't nobody been through this.
Strongest people on the planet, right?
And if it don't kill you, make you stronger.
That's right. Look, now, we're at 306. We've been gone for more than an hour. So you know I'm going to have to ask you to come back because we got so much to cover.
No doubt.
But I just want to thank you. And I just want to love you for a moment by thanking you for taking time out of your day, your time, and all of this work that you're doing on a daily basis in your schools and the teachings and what have you to be with me for this wonderful hour, but also to be with me in this lifetime. I am so happy that I showed up and you showed up at this time. It's absolutely amazing. Thank you. But I would like to ask you, can you come back and we can talk about this and go even deeper and maybe even do a Q&A and get some questions from the audience?
I look forward to it, my brother. I thank you also because your time is valuable too. And if it weren't for people like you, what purpose would I really have? You offer me an opportunity to be able to speak to our beloved community.
Yes.
Who no matter who you are, we are all in a position where we're trying to find our way back into a much better spot.
Yes.
And, you know, whatever role I can play in this, whatever role that I can be as a part of this process, I am just happy. I thank all of those who are watching your program, who have taken valuable time out of their day also, because all of our time is valuable. So I thank us for being us, and I encourage us to keep on keeping on, because it ain't over until we win.
Absolutely. God bless Hotep, Brother Kwame. Thank you so much.
Hotep, and God bless you, my brother. Keep on keeping on, brother.